three things that had to be in every tale, that the guy was a drunk or a philanderer. It's the same with a criminal record. You can quickly see what the story is. And sometimes in the printed proceedings at the Old Bailey and the jail delivery of Newgate, you can read and hear the stubbornness, the resistance, the profanity of the defendants as they faced a jury of property owners and who were hell-bent on punishing them by hanging, by whipping, by transportation to Virginia, or later Australia. And then with property deeds in Ireland, I spent a long time. This was like legal work. I wasn't a lawyer, but you had to pay some money to get access to do title searches, and you could find out old documents, and they would describe the commons as they are being privatized. And so that became another source of information. And then the poetry was a third, because the poets see and know things that I don't. So I wanted there, and they can speak with a authenticity and veracity and truthfulness that I often found to be of biblical importance.
Great. Well, let's talk now about the commons.
Okay.
One of the things that is, I think, most innovative about this book is that it recovers this lost history in which really many hundreds of thousands of people in England and Ireland and other parts of the world are being forced off of lands, usually with violence, lands that they and their families had occupied in many cases for hundreds of years, so that improving landlords, as they like to call themselves, could privatize that property and use it for other purposes. So this is, I think, a very original part of your argument, to say that the struggle over the commons is one of the most important things going on in the revolutionary 1790s. And don't forget, folks, as Peter's already said, we have the French Revolution, the Haitian Revolution, the Irish Rebellion, the growth of radicalism in England, slave revolts everywhere in the New World. This is an extraordinarily explosive moment. But you've come and put something into that history which I think has never been fully appreciated before, the struggle of the commons. So tell us about that and how that occupies such a key place in this book.
It occupies a key place because when Despard was hanged and Catherine returned to Ireland, more ships embarked from England for the West African coast, more slave ships than ever before in human history. At the same time, more acts of enclosure were passed than ever before in human history. Parliamentary act of enclosure is a legal edict that takes away common rights and common land from common people and privatizes it behind a fence or a hedge. And to do that was a technical matter of surveyors and map makers, but they were called terriers. And that's what we have in the lobby. It's a kind of terrier that shows, though the English ones weren't done on leaves, on taro leaves, or kalo leaves, but they would expropriate slowly over several centuries every particle of land in England. Until a few years ago, Common Way Act was passed under Tony Blair, and you can still walk on private land. I'm not going to say it's like a beach here, but there are some places, there's still some remnants of common lands in England. This was the major terror of the time. I said common land, but you see, the same thing was true of the hand. The hand was being enclosed as well. That's the factory. Beforehand, people worked at home. But the domestic system is now job with machines and to prevent people from taking the materials of their labor for their own use, they would enclose the hand worker in factory walls. That's the origin of the factory. So it's the enclosure of the hand and of the land. Is this the time for that poem?
Yeah.
Okay.
How about a poem?
Wait till you hear this. And I would like to have some backup, if I may, from the jury. This is the first time I've got some. Can I do that? Some beautiful ladies to help me. The law locks up the man or woman who steals the goose from off the common, but lets the greater villain loose who steals the common from the goose. Yeah, that's... Weren't they good? Would you like to do that, please? You can do it. Let's do it.
Yep.
Shall we? The law locks up the man or woman who steals the goose from off the common, but lets the greater villain loose who steals the common from the goose. If you can get that, I think you have the key to the 1790s, because that is the third man that's incarcerated. Penitentiaries as well. This disciplines that goose who no longer has access to the commons, put them in the pen, the penitentiary.
And if you would describe enclosure process, we've already talked about enclosure of the land, enclosure of the hand, but as a world historical process which applies to Hawaii as well as other parts of the world, how do you think about that? That's a big part of your work.
But didn't I do that when I said the enclosure act is parish by parish, enclosing the common field behind a fence or a hedge? There is a process to it. It's a contested part. They have to do it inch by inch. They can't do it the way they did in the Soviet Union, you know, which was in one generation. They had to do it, as I say, parish by parish over many centuries. It was an inching. It was a, what do they say, death by a thousand cuts. These are 1,000 forms of enclosure all over, and it's somewhat part of that English, you know, part of Englishness is your local pleasure up to a little village, you know, the commons right there, and we're going to have a jolly good game. So, there's this localism.
Okay, now here's something else about Peter that I know from having worked with him. He really loves strange words. So one of the things you can use his book to do is to build your vocabulary. And when he can't find a strange word, sometimes he'll make one up. Like thanatocracy.
Yeah.
What is thanatocracy, Peter?
Well, it's something that's all around us. It's governed by death. You know, John Locke, the guy who influenced these folks, the English philosopher, he was a philosopher against the commons, against Jared Winstanley. John Locke said that sovereignty, you defined it, is the ability to make laws punishable by death. That was his definition of sovereignty. In contrast to Thomas Paine, who said the people are sovereign. So there was the theoretical basis for this new word, thanatocracy. But there's more to it than just hanging in the criminal code. There's also the planning of famine, the planning of who's going to live and who's going to die by price structures of food, of grain. And so the concept of thanatocracy, most of us approach this demography by birth, or quote, population explosion, to use an expression that is highly problematic, but it's also a planning of death as well. And the state has been part of that, and the evidence is just frightening to read. When you see the deliberate state decisions on not to provide food for large parts. two aspects of Thanatocracy. So,
okay. Yeah, that's very good. I want to talk now a little bit about the research strategy of this book. Because one of the things that Peter does is shows this unbelievable kind of intersection of historical forces, events, publications between the years roughly 1800 and 1803. 1803 is when Ned Despard is hanged. So in order to understand what's going on in the world at that time, you pursued, I think, almost all of the events, scientific writings. Tell us how you went about that.
I don't know. It drives some kind of people, friends, crazy. Anything that happens at that time, I think there might be a connection. I just start out with coincidences and then go from there. You know, if it happened in 1803, November 1802 was the trial of Despard. At the same time, there's a guy in Manchester, November 1802, giving a lecture on his atomic theory. It's the first statement of atomic theory. At the same time in France, the term biology is invented. That replaces it. So a relationship to the Earth, to the cosmos, to the material world is undergoing a change in this time. Or Hegel, the great continental philosopher, is influenced at this time. Whereas Humboldt, the guy who goes around the world and sees the world in a new way now with isotherms. So the concept of the globe is changing. The entire cosmology of imperialism and so-called civilization is undergoing a huge change. Geology, and the study of the strata beneath us is becoming scientific. The theory of the Earth is published by John Hutton, and he regards the Earth as a machine and says so. So this is the science of the time. And it's in contrast now to, this is the secular age. We're taught that it's the culmination of the Enlightenment. If you look at it from the standpoint of common people, or if you look at it from the standpoint of, well, I think it has to do with what they might be Western dualism. You know, the material world